Hi, good evening. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Tracy Dolan, and I am the Deputy Commissioner for the Department of Health. Thanks so much for taking some time to come and learn a little bit more and talk to us this evening. We will be this evening hearing from a variety of people. We've brought quite a group with us today to talk to you a little more and to share the results of the exposure assessment that we did. So today we have with us Dr. Chen, Commissioner of Health. We have Dr. Wolf at Boston Children's Hospital, and I'll be introducing him a little more later. We brought a team of scientists from the Department of Health. We brought staff from our local office. We've also got the Secretary of the Agency of Natural Resources with us. And we've also got the Deputy Attorney General with us. So a variety of people who can hopefully answer the questions you have. About a year ago, we got a call from the Department of Environmental Conservation, which is a department in the Agency of Natural Resources. And we got a call, and they described the situation they'd found with PFOA. And they called us and said, we're going to need you to establish a level so that we can move forward and determine what kind of actions we need to take. And so at the Department of Health, we got our scientists to work. Our toxicologist led up the work to establish the MCL for PFOA for Vermont. We also moved forward learning as much as we could about what it meant to be exposed to PFOA and disseminated that information as quickly as we could. And then eventually we set up our blood testing clinics, and we have 10 blood testing clinics over the past year, testing upwards of 400 people in the Bennington area. And now we're here today. We've provided results to many people. I think there are still some people who haven't received their results at the last clinic, but provided the results, and we're here today to share a little more about what we learned from the overall assessment and what we learned about the community, and also to learn and hear more from other experts in the field and to answer your questions. And I just want to highlight, we've all been so impressed with the patience and the engagement of your community around what was obviously a very stressful time and continues to be a stressful time, and we really appreciate that. The conversation has always been respectful and really mutually helpful, so thank you so much for your patience and for all you've done to help work with us to learn more about PFOA. I'd like to first introduce the Commissioner of Health, and he will go over the results of the study with you.
So good afternoon, and again, thank you all for coming. I had to relay a story to you that really, I think, highlights both why we're here, and I'm sure to a large extent why you're here. I had the honor, really, of hearing Dr. Ramona Hanna Atish, who's the pediatrician who really blew the cover off of the Flint water crisis last week, and I had dinner with her, and it really just underscores what we, all of us in this room and in government and in medicine, really take for granted, which is we all have the expectation and should have the expectation of clean water and safe water. So, I mean, that's why we're here, and what we're here to do, what I'm here to do, is to present the results of this assessment that we promised you. So when we made the commitment to draw the blood, we did it in an effort to better understand very important things about the environmental exposure to you as individuals up here in North Bennington. And if I can get technology to work, I'll be happy. All right. What's fine. So I think importantly at the outset is to really relay again the expectations. What did we expect? What were out of this study? And what were our goals in the study? And really, clearly, the most important thing was to make sure that no additional actions were needed to prevent continued exposure to residents, to better understand how people in Bennington, in the Bennington community, were exposed to PFOA, and to provide you as community members and all the others with their actual blood PFOA level and how it compares to background levels in the U.S. population. So the top line results, just to really lay it out very clearly at the very beginning, is that there were no surprises, and that our study indicates that drinking water from contaminated wells was the main source of exposure to PFOA to residents in North Bennington. Had we not found that, then we would have to be looking for other sources of PFOA, but we didn't find that. And so therefore, the actions we took in terms of the bottled water and the filtered water now were exactly the appropriate actions that needed to happen at the outset to protect the public health. Just to review and refresh who is eligible, and we had to cast, actually to do this assessment, we actually had to cast a wider net, which was not only people who had PFOA in their wells, we needed to, people who had clean wells but lived in the area. We had to have people that worked in the area or worked or lived in the old factory. So we you know, anybody who had the well tested by DEC or had lived in one of those homes in the past 8 years or lived or worked at the Kent Fat Plant. And as you can see, we had a tremendous response from the members of the committee. 477 individuals signed up for blood testing, and as part of the assessment, 5 were excluded from the analysis, and of the 472, 65 were occupational participants, and the other 407 were non-occupational participants. Just to note that we had a recent blood sampling done in November. Those results were not included in this analysis and will be forthcoming shortly. Clearly, as many of you saw, this was a pretty significant logistical challenge of actually drawing blood from over 500 people now, and it would be short-sighted not to thank Southwestern Vermont Medical Center, all the people in the Medical Reserve Corps, and the individuals who work, dedicated and passionate individuals that work for the state government and the health department. So there were 10 clinics and upwards of 100 staff that participated. It's important to understand the initial variable that we tie it all back to, which is your water, and the levels of PFOA in your water. And as you can see from this graph, the range in the participants range from non-detect, people who were in the municipal water supply, to people who had almost 3,000 parts per trillion. The average among the participants was 81 parts per trillion. So here's the distribution of the PFOA in blood in the people who were tested as part of this Bennington investigation. The range, as you can see, goes from 0.3 all the way up to 1,125 micrograms per liter. And throughout this presentation, I'm going to use the term average a lot, but we're really using a more precise calculation called the geometric mean. And what that really is, another way of calculating an average, where you see a wide and non-normally distributed range of results. But it's a very common methodology. Otherwise, you wouldn't really be able to compare apples to apples. The two dark lines you see on the right really demonstrate that we've changed the measuring intervals and gone over to where the very high levels are, but smaller numbers. We used these numbers and really compared them to what we'll call the normal underlying American populations through the NHANES survey, which is the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey, part of the CDC's ongoing evaluation of Americans, of their health, and of substances in their blood. And we use that data to really set a baseline so we could tell people what their results are. Were their levels higher, lower, or roughly the same as the average American? And you can see the results. The U.S. average is 2.1 micrograms per liter. The Bennington average was 10 micrograms per liter. And importantly, there is currently no established PFOA level at which a health effect is known, nor is there a level that is clearly associated with a past or future health problem. So unfortunately, the uncertainty is there, that we can't equate a PFOA level with any known or predicted health effects. And as a reminder, the population is 2.1 overall versus the Bennington number average, which was 10. And we find that overall, the individuals who worked with the PFOA had higher levels in this exposure assessment than individuals who had it in the drinking water. Just to give you some comparison about other, as you know, there's more than one place in this country where they're dealing with this challenging emerging contaminant related to its manufacturing use. Just across the river, which is really what led us to actually start doing the well testing here in Bennington County. You can see the results in the Portsmouth, New Hampshire, Minnesota, Decatur, Alabama, Hoosick Falls, New York, and the C8 study in the Ohio River Valley in Ohio and West Virginia. Some of the differences that you could see were probably related to different PFOA levels in water, and also the people they allowed to participate in their particular surveying. Here are some of the other results that we found, that the PFOA concentrations in blood were higher among men compared to women. And among women age 60 plus, they had higher levels compared to women age 18 to 59. This is consistent with data in other studies, so there's nothing different here. And we expect that the differences are due to whether it be occupational histories, sex-specific differences in the way our bodies handle PFOA, and what consumer products we use, because we know they're known to be ubiquitous in consumer products in the past. And studies have shown that PFOA can leave women's bodies through menstruation, childbirth, and breastfeeding. So again, to underscore the results, the primary result of this study was that PFOA concentrations in water strongly correlated with PFOA levels in blood. Adding to this was the effect we saw of the cumulative effects. So not only was it related to the level in your water, but it was also related to how long you lived there and how much water you drink. We didn't. So the more water you drink per day and the longer you lived there, the more likely you would have a cumulative exposure and higher blood level of PFOA. Interestingly enough, we did not see this correlation with bottled water. So I think not surprising there at all that bottled water should not contain PFOA, and people who drank more bottled, there was not a correlation between how much bottled water you drank and your blood PFOA level. Other study findings relate to that I think are important to mention. One is that really underscores the relationship between drinking water and PFOA exposure with the people who actually were living at the ChemFab site, so exposed to the environment there, but were on municipal water, did not have a significantly elevated PFOA level. So again, that's because they had a municipal water that was not contaminated with PFOA. Again, underscoring that it was the water and not necessarily the environment. Some of our first pass evaluation of the produce showed a connection between eating produce and elevated levels. But one of the things we do in a statistical analysis of this sort is to actually try to tease down. And what we tease down is that we found that those individuals who had ate the produce, who had higher levels, were individuals that also drank more of the contaminated water. So in the end, it was the contaminated water that they were drinking rather than the produce that they ate that was likely responsible for the elevated PFOA levels. We still advise individuals not to ingest contaminated water, obviously. And the Agency of Agriculture recommends not watering gardens with PFOA contaminated water. As I mentioned, occupational exposure tended to be higher than exposure in drinking water. So you see the level here of workers in Vermont, the level being 59 micrograms per liter, remembering that the general population level, this was about 10 micrograms. So essentially six times higher in people who were occupationally exposed. You could also see that the levels are considerably lower than some of the other places that where workers were exposed to PFOA during the course of their work. Some of this certainly may have been related to the fact that the plant closed down in 2002. And so, as we know, PFOA leaves your body with time, probably half of it is gone in a time period of about four to five years. So you're seeing likely the result of that in this graph comparing workers from different sites. This is an important one that really relates to the following slides. This is not an easy concept to understand, but I'll do my best. And that is, what is the difference between association and causation? Association really, or correlation, indicates there's a link or connection between two factors. And really what we're talking about here is an exposure and a disease or a condition. And it suggests that the exposure may contribute to the disease, but does not mean that it's proven to be the cause of the disease. So there's an association there that is statistically relevant, but there's not the underlying science to say that this is A causes B. So more study is needed to really to make that link to causation. So causation, on the other hand, is that when we know that there's a true pathway that leads from exposure to disease, that's based on strong association and other factors, it means that an event or a condition plays a role in causing a disease to occur, and can only be concluded when a number of valid studies have been determined the same relationship between an exposure and disease. So importantly, association doesn't mean that it's not going to happen, but it doesn't mean for sure that we can make that connection, that it will be caused by A causes B. And I think from a public health perspective, if we have association, we can actually, and we did take action. We have association on many of the things related to PFOA, and that's why we made the decision to set the level as low as we did, and that's why we've worked with our partners at DEC and ANR to ensure that clean drinking water was available and that we remediated the water contamination. And a lot of our information about associations, the health effects, outcomes associated with PFOA come from the C8 science panel. And this was between the years of 2005 and 2013, a series of studies were done, conducted a large population in West Virginia that were exposed. Again, it's important to understand that this is a study of about 70,000 people. And you can do a lot with a study of 70,000 people that you can't do with a study of 472 people. So that's an important thing. So the project was part of a class action lawsuit, and it gathered those samples and then followed them. And what they found was the average water level in the residence was 83 micrograms. Again, going back to Bennington, was 10. In C8 in West Virginia, it was 83. The science panel had published studies in very respected journals, and the results of these studies, along with the information from ATSDR, the CDC sister agency that deals with toxic chemicals, really provided us the background for the health effects that are listed in all our information packets and the advice that we gave to your to local clinicians. So these are some of the health effects from C8 that were found to be associated with PFOA. increased lipids, blood lipids, cholesterol is an example, uric acid and liver enzymes, decreased immune response, pregnancy-induced hypertension, decreased birth weight, thyroid disease, and testicular kidney cancer. Again, these studies do not prove a cause and effect relationship, as I mentioned in the previous slide, association, not causation. And additionally, some of these outcomes would not be actually clinically relevant. And they're just things that are found in your blood. They may not actually affect how your health is. I think another thing is important is that most of the things on this list are part of a routine screening as part of your normal healthcare, your yearly exam, especially as an adult. And you'll hear more about this study and the health effects from Dr. Wolf shortly. Before we discuss our findings related to health effects, I wanted to speak a little bit about the statistical power or the statistical challenges of a small study. In general, the less common outcomes you have, the larger numbers you need to actually prove that relationship or that association. So a study of 70,000 will have a lot more power to find rare things than a study of 477. So this is what I'm trying to paint for you. The fact that we had a small number of people in our study, those 472, and the fact that no association was detected with some of the health outcomes in the study of Bennington and North Bennington really doesn't rule out the possibility that an association exists. Analysis of these outcomes were actually not completed when there were five or fewer people with a specific disease. And that's important, again, because of the low numbers we had, because we did not feel we had the statistical power to actually make a comparison of the rates of those conditions. And then finally, the health department does not report conditions with an N of less than six. So five or less won't be reported, and that's really as much as anything. Vermont's a small state. If we start talking about diseases, then we start knowing about who has those diseases. So we have to make a decision that limits us in terms of patient confidentiality. This was true for two outcomes that obviously people are worried about and concerned about, and that is kidney cancer and testicular cancer. So the outcomes of our study were able to demonstrate that there was an association, again, remembering what that means, between being treated for high blood pressure and PFOA blood levels, high blood pressure during pregnancy, and high cholesterol. Again, it's important to keep in mind that for example, being treated for high blood pressure was not one that's generally found in the literature, was not found as part of C8, but that there are a lot of things that go into determining one's having high blood pressure. Could be weight, could be other dietary habits, and these are things that we did not take into consideration when we did the study. The overall action step here is that if you have these conditions, they are generally found on routine medical evaluations and preventive health screenings, and that's something that's important for you to talk with your provider. The health department provided information for healthcare providers. We sent out four health advisories, including the ATSDR information. We provided clinical guidance that can be found on the web at our website. I'm sitting here today, and we're sitting here today. All of us are committed that this is not the end of our response, but that we will continually monitor the medical and scientific literature and update both individuals in the community and also providers in the community that need to know when new information comes out. There's a fact sheet that's available for clinicians, and we also have Dr. Wolf, who's generously agreed to be a consultant to any of your providers in terms of questions that may arise Obviously, people are available at the health department to try to answer your questions. So I think I'd acknowledge, and everybody would acknowledge, and most importantly, you in this room, that there's it's really how it, relatively unsatisfactory it is to have all of this uncertainty. Not to be able to tell you this level will have this problem, or this level won't have this problem. But I think it's also important to understand, what's the future for you. And this is one thing that's certain, and that is that the half-life of the PFOA is somewhere between 2 and 5 years. That means every two to five years, your blood level will decrease by half. And that this is a chart that illustrates what happens. So if you're 50 today, in a half-life, in that 2 to 4 years, you should be around 25, and you can take it further and further. So this is something that's really clear, and it's especially important to understand that if the ongoing exposure is stopped, if you're drinking clean water, then this is what will happen to everybody's PFOA levels. This has been shown in studies. This is a study from Germany where they tested blood and tested blood again in 2 years, and you can see the significant change that occurred. So again, just to reinforce that even though we spend a lot of time looking at these levels, and undoubtedly these levels are important to each and every one of you, there's no level that predicts the health outcome, and there's no recommended way to actually remove PFOA. So there's nothing that, no intervention in terms of increasing it short of removing yourself from continued exposure. So the key points in our study really are that the primary exposure pathway is confirmed. PFOA in your blood comes from PFOA in your water. That the association with health effects that were found reflect findings similar to larger studies. That the blood test itself can't tell you if a condition was caused by PFOA or if you will have one of those associated health effects in the future, but that your levels will decrease by half every 3 to 4 years. The recommendations that we would give to individuals include nothing new here, not to use the water for drinking and cooking, preparing food, brush your teeth, watering gardens. If you're healthy, if you have a health concern, it's really important that you consult with your healthcare provider. It's important that that you've been exposed becomes part of your medical records, and that there are a future blood testing clinic plan for eligible people who have not already had PFOA in our blood, tested in their blood. We will we're committed to monitoring the scientific literature. And as new developments occur, we will make the community, including healthcare providers, aware of anything new. So I want to thank you for your time. I want to thank, obviously, all of the people listed on the slide for both actually getting the results, getting the blood test results, doing hundreds and hundreds of hours of doing the statistics, checking them twice and three times, and coming up with this elaborate presentation. Thank you.
There are probably some questions. Let me just briefly go over the agenda so you can see where those fit in. We're going to have two speakers. So we had Dr. Chen, and then Dr. Wolf will be speaking in a moment, speaking again a little more to the health piece. Then we're going to pause for questions and comments. After that, we're going to talk to some of the partners that we've been working with. We'll speak with Captain Summers. We'll speak with the Secretary of Agency of Natural Resources, Julie Moore. We'll speak with you, and she'll be able to take some questions if you have any about the updates on the water supply. We'll hear from Josh Diamond, the Deputy Attorney General, so if there are questions unique to him, you'll be able to ask those, and he'll be able to get back to you. So we're going to introduce our next speaker, and then we will pause for your questions and comments. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Alan Wolf. He's a pediatrician and a medical toxicologist. He's a professor of pediatrics at Harvard Medical School, an attending physician at Boston Children's Hospital, and the hospital's associate chief medical education officer. He's also the director of the Region 1 New England Pediatric Environmental Health Specialty Unit, and he directs its fellowship training program in pediatric and environmental health. He's been kind enough to come here and speak to us today and has also made himself available for some consultation to providers in the community. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Wolf.
Thank you very much, Tracy. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for the invitation. I think you've heard a very erudite communication from your Commissioner Chan, and I'd like to elaborate on some of the science that he had in his presentation. Yep. There's, when you go to Great Britain and you go to London, and if you ride the their equivalent of the T, which they call the tube, this won't be news to you, but they have these quaint, somewhat British signs in the subway reminding you to watch out when you step off the train or step onto the train, because there's a gap between the platform and the train itself. We don't bother with that in Boston, you're on your own. But there they have the sign that says, mind the gap. And as Dr. Chan alluded to, I'm gonna talk a little bit about the science more generally of perfluorinated compounds, or PFCs, also known as perfluoral alkyl substances, or PFADs. But in interpreting the risk, I think one of the key topics to keep in mind is to mind the gaps, and I'll point these out as we go along. This is brought to you by our Region 1 Pediatric Environmental Health Specialty Unit, which covers all of New England, and is funded in part by the APSDR and by the EPA. And we have no financial relationships with any manufacturers of commercial products, and will not discuss unapproved investigational uses. Just a little bit about the Pediatric Environmental Health Specialty Units, which exist across the country, and they're mapped pretty much to the EPA's regions across the country to provide a fair amount of integrated, multidisciplinary, family-focused approach to healthcare for children and pregnant and lactating women in preventing and managing illnesses that might be caused by environmental hazards. As Tracy mentioned, we have a fellowship training program, and we provide educational, consultative, and research services to communities. And that's how I came to be here tonight. Just to remind you some of the properties and the chemistry of PFAS. PFOA is one of this class of compounds, which include PFAS and PFEX, and a bunch of other similar related chemicals in this class. These are somewhat unique chemicals in terms of they're slippery, they're stain resistant, they were used in Teflon to make nonstick surfaces for pots and pans. They have relatively long half-lives, depending on the length of the chain, the carbon chain that you see here depicted. And notably, PFAS stopped production in the United States in 2002 and was phased out largely voluntarily by companies, PFOA, and worldwide was to be phased out of production by 2015. That is, just about a year and a half ago. As I mentioned, these chemicals were used for a variety of applications, used in cookware. They did get into foodstuffs, including vegetables and fish. They were used in pizza boxes, for example, or microwave popcorn containers because they resisted sticking of those different ingredients. They were used to cut down on stains. They were used as finishes for carpeting. And you can see in your upper right, they were also used in firefighting foams. And when firefighting foams were used in some facilities, including military facilities, sometimes those PFASs would seep into the groundwater. They were also used in ski wax, which is in the middle there. Thought you might be interested in that in Vermont. The routes of exposure for most of us is through water and a little bit through food as well, but mainly contaminated water. And as you can see to the left, that's distinctly different from children who also put their hands in their mouths and they eat non-food items. They're more exposed to household dust as an additional route of exposure that's shown in red in this slide. And so they differ a little bit from adults. For most of us, the main route is from contaminated water. As I mentioned, and this is the first gap I'm going to talk about, and that is uncertainty in PFAS, in that there are many chemicals, and you can see a listing here, just some of the different chemicals in this class. This was from dust samples from 39 Wisconsin homes, and yet there are very few studies on some of these members of the class. Notably, PFOA and PFAS have been around the longest, and they are the most studied in terms of science that we know about this particular class of what the EPA has called an emerging pollutant. I also want to give you a little perspective in terms of technically what we're able to do these days. This is, you know, most of us is water, a lot of, you know, some fat and some protein in kilograms. Some essential metabolites such as potassium and sodium, calcium, phosphorus, glycogen, and so forth have smaller quantities. And in that, you know, on his left wrist there, part of his arm is the other that's not shown or identified in this cartoon. And you can see within the other, hemoglobin, for example, is present in a concentration of about 1,300,000 micrograms per liter, as opposed to PFAS, which, depending on your level, can average around 20 micrograms per liter. You have a little bit of aluminum in your body, too, at 15 mics per liter in your blood, and lead in your blood for children at the CDC's reference range is about 50 mics per liter. So I think it's important to keep in mind, Dr. Chan alluded to this too, that when we're measuring it in water, we're measuring it in parts per trillion. And when we're measuring it in blood, we're measuring it in parts per billion, very small amounts. And we need to pay attention to those small amounts, but it gives you a little bit of perspective. These are some of the sites in New England that so far we know about or suspect as having some water contamination with PFAS chemicals, including Hoosick Falls, as was mentioned, North Bennington, but also Portsmouth, New Hampshire, Merrimack, Manchester, Litchfield, Bedfield, and Amherst. They're looking at 20 other sites in New Hampshire, water sources, to see if they have similar issues with some contamination. Well, what do we know about PFAS? Some of the information that we know comes from occupational studies. Some of the information comes from animal studies. This is just a slide where I've put some of those animal studies where it can cause altered gene expression and testosterone synthesis, behavioral studies, reproductive studies showing adverse effects, tumors in mouse models, changes in insulin and leptin levels, neonatal viability in some animal studies, increased liver weight in some animals, immunotoxicity in some animal studies, mammary gland development in others. But the gap number two that we have in knowledge is that we have a lot of concerns about PFAS because of the basic science research and the animal research, some of which I notice has been done in this building, in this biology center, and is being done around the country. But that doesn't always translate into relevance for the human experience. So the gap number two, gap number one is there are a lot of PFAS compounds and we don't have a lot of studies on all of them. Gap number two is that there is interspecies variation. So one representation from that is these different PFAS chemicals and their half-lives as opposed to different members of the class between species of rat, monkey, or human. And you can see that the half-lives and how these compounds are handled and their biological fates differs from animal to animal. Down at the bottom, I've just mentioned one difference between the murine models, that is mice and rats versus humans. And that is a receptor called the peroxisome proliferator activated receptor alpha, or PPAR alpha, which regulates gene transcription, lipid metabolism, inflammation, fatty acid metabolism, and hepatocyte metabolism. This is a very active and robust receptor in animal models, not so much in humans. That's not how humans, for the most part, handle PFAS compounds. So we can have some suspicion from animal models, and we want to pursue what they're telling us, but they may or may not be applicable to humans and clinical outcomes. Dr. Chan mentioned the C8 study, which was a health project that continues, and he mentioned it was a study of over 69,000 participants from West Virginia and Ohio in the Ohio River Valley that were exposed to PFOA from a chemical plant. I think what's important is to note not only what they found, but what they didn't find. So they looked for more than 41 different conditions, including hypertension, coronary heart disease, stroke, chronic kidney disease, liver disease, osteoarthritis, Parkinson's, autoimmune, common infections, neurodevelopmental disorders, ADHD, learning disabilities, autism, asthma, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, diabetes, birth defects, miscarriages, stillbirths, and preterm births, and at least in one study, low birth weight, and they found no association. As he also mentioned, they did find a probable association, probable, between high cholesterol, thyroid disease, ulcerative colitis, testicular cancer, kidney cancer, and pregnancy-related hypertension. So that was a key epidemiologic study and a population that was followed. Again, it showed some associations with some conditions and no associations with many others. I'm not going to belabor this, but this is just one of the studies that use C8 data by Knox and Associates, and you can see for each graph, going from left to right, are the population from low PFOA levels to high PFOA levels. And if you just look at the upper graph on the right, thyroxin, you can see that, yeah, it does seem to go up a little bit in this population. It goes up, you know, within the range of about 7.2 to about 8.2 or 8.5. So they did see a trend, and they did see an association. Is that clinically relevant? No, really isn't, because a normal T4 level is between 7 and about 10 or 11. What they saw was very little incremental change between groups. Some change was there, but certainly not enough to draw any conclusions in terms of causation. So the state of science in 2017 is that we're looking in a variety of places, possibly the thyroid. We know that PFAS are excreted in breast milk, possibly related to kidney cancer, possibly related to liver enzyme levels, possibly related to autoimmune disease or some immune toxicity or ulcerative colitis, related to cholesterol levels, lipid metabolism, and uric acid, possibly related to later onset of obesity, and possibly related to testosterone levels and the presence of testicular cancer. But these are all associations, and some of them are stronger than others, and some of them, frankly, the scientific evidence still is not there to conclude anything definitive. Again, for women during pregnancy, just the highlight at the bottom of the slide, that PFAS has possibly been related to their ability to get pregnant, also known as fecundity, possibly related to hypertension in pregnancy or preeclampsia, and associated with small changes in the birth weight of affected infants from these women with high levels. The third gap that I want to talk about in terms of the science tonight is children's vulnerability. Many of the studies that have been done in humans have been done in occupational settings and involving workers. Many of the studies have been involved with adults, and there are far fewer studies that involve children. And this slide just shows that children are not little adults. They differ in terms of their forming brain tissue, their immature ability to detoxify certain chemicals, the fact that they're breastfeeding, they have nutritional differences, they have smaller size and weight, longer lifespans, poor cognitive discrimination, so they'll put anything in their mouths, they mimic us as adults, they have pica, that is putting non-food items in their mouth, they're curious, they're mobile, they crawl, and they rely on others for their safety. And these are some of the studies that have started to look at children and PFOA and PFAS levels. And you can see here, for example, my friend David Bellinger, and he looked at 6 to 12-year-olds in the Ohio Valley and looked at their IQ and their math and language scores, showed no association with either their levels or that of their mothers. Similar association in similar study in the Ohio Valley looking at over 1,300 5 to 11-year-olds found no association with ADHD. Another study in Denmark looking at 1,400 pregnancy PFOA and PFAS levels and then looking later at infants 6 and 18 months of age found no association with their ability to achieve their developmental milestones. Another study from the C8 study looked at 12,000 pregnancies, found no association with low birth weight, birth defects, or miscarriage. Grand Chain in a study of 587 5 and 7-year-olds found a slight association between levels of PFOA and PFAS and low diphtheria and tetanus antibodies in those children who had been immunized. So again, an association there. The last gap I just want to mention tonight is the gap that we're trying to address tonight and that your public health leadership is trying to address with you, and that is communicating environmental complexity to families and healthcare providers in the community. PFAS are toxic in experimental animals. Further study is required in adults, and studies in children have not yet shown any definitive results. As Dr. Chan mentioned, since these chemicals are only measured experimentally, testing is not recommended. There's no treatment to remove PFAS from the body. Efforts should be focusing on preventing further exposure And as usual, routine physicals and well childcare visits are recommended. So that's what I had to convey to you tonight, and that is some uncertainty. That we have many PFAS chemicals. The one you're particularly concerned about here in North Bennington is PFOA. There are others, and some of those chemicals we have very few studies of. That there's some interspecies variation that may not allow us to extrapolate what we're finding in basic science or animal studies to how humans will react to the same compounds. We know less about the effects of these chemicals on children than we do about adults, and what we're trying to do tonight is to communicate with you, answer your questions about the complexity of this particular contaminant in the water. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. We're going to open it up for some questions. I'm going to ask Dr. Chin and Dr. Wolf to stand here. We've also got a bench team here that's going to help us out as needed. We've got Lori Cragen, our state epidemiologist, Sarah Vose, our state toxicologist, and David Grass, our environmental health science chief, who may health surveillance chief, who may also be involved in some of the questions and answers. And so if anyone has a question, then we have a microphone.
Because the effects are cumulative in the human condition, and the Vermont action level is 20 parts per trillion, should a person who has 15 parts per trillion in their drinking water be at all concerned?
As you know, we've come a long way with that level. I think that, you know, a couple of years back it was probably around 400, got down to 100. The EPA's lifetime risk level is 70 and ours is 20. I think those levels incorporate a lifetime risk, given I'm looking at our toxicologist here. And so I think that that level of 20 is protective.
Hello? I just have a question about the health effect association study that you did. I look in the population that you looked at, 472 folks, a large number of those were relatively low relative to the whole population, higher than average. And so I'm wondering, you know, perhaps over the time frame involved anyway, health effects seen in those individuals with the lower levels might be less, and that would influence the overall statistical output. Whereas I'm wondering if you isolated it all, even using some non-parametric methods, the population of people who had higher levels, just say like above 20 or 30 micrograms per liter, and observed any greater associations in that population.
I don't know if one of the statisticians, people might want to answer, but I think my understanding is, first of all, the numbers are so small that if you just took out the higher numbers, the numbers would shrink to a level that you probably couldn't detect much of anything. I think secondly, and I'm going to look at Dr. Grass over here to correct me, but we did try to correlate the levels in blood with those conditions. So as the higher levels, if you had a higher level, and you had these conditions, and that would be that association. So that's built into our analysis.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. So you'd want to include both the people at the lower levels, with lower levels of PFOA in their blood, who generally had lower levels of PFOA in their water, and those people with higher levels of PFOA in their water, who generally had higher levels of PFOA in their blood. And that's how we were able to see that relationship.
I can understand it dropping out of your bloodstream after 3 or 4 years and being I keep asking the question, is it leaving your body or is it bedding itself in your kidneys or your liver and just hanging out for the rest of your life? because I haven't been able to find anything on the net that shows there's any study that's showing that it's actually leaving your body or what it's doing. So here's the question.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm Sarah Bush. I'm a toxicologist. So the way that PFOA leaves your body is through the kidney. So your kidney is made up of about a million little filtration units. And first your kidney filters, you know, the kidney's job is to clean your blood and take out all the waste products. So your kidney does filter out the water and a lot of nutrients, things that we need in our body in step one. And then in step two, your kidney takes back in to the blood all the nutrients, all the things that it needs, all the things that our blood needs. And unfortunately, in that step, the kidney puts some of that PFOA back into our blood, but some of it does go out into the urine. So that's why it is a very, it has a long half-life, because as your kidney tries to get rid of it, your kidney accidentally puts some of it back in your blood and some of it out of your body.
Okay, that makes sense, because I was just thinking in terms of how much your blood gets filtered through your kidneys, it seems like it would leave faster. But that answers my question. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Chen, you had mentioned, I didn't understand this. I know I got it right, that looking at potential health outcomes out of the 472 people that might be associated with PFOA contamination, that there were five people, but because you have a reporting level of six, you didn't report it. Was that what you said? That there were five individuals that had health conditions that might be associated with?
No, what I said is that there were some of the uncommon health outcomes. May have had individuals that had that in the study, but if the numbers were less, five or less, we would not report them for the confidentiality piece. And secondly, the power, statistical power of a study this small would not be able to distinguish a true relationship in terms of association.
Okay, so so you're not saying that there was any particular number of people?
No.
You're saying if the numbers were five or less, you wouldn't have reported it. And I have one other question for both you and Dr. Wolf about this association versus causation issue. I am aware, and perhaps you are, of several verdicts, jury verdicts, in which the juries found by the civil standard, I guess, which is not a scientific standard, for abundance of the evidence, that the PFOA contamination did cause the health effects that were the subject of those trials. And I was wondering if you had familiarized yourself with the science and the studies that were presented to the juries in those cases.
I can't speak to the forensic evidence that would be introduced in a judicial setting. But I absolutely endorse what Commissioner Chan was saying about the difference between an association versus causation. And within that, you can even parse the strength of the association, consistency of the association, the weight of the evidence, and those other aspects, publication bias. So jury decisions are one thing, but in terms of science, those are the principles that we try to invoke when we make that leap. And it's on the basis of the weight of the evidence, the strength and consistency of the evidence, and the other factors, what's known as Bradford's criteria, that go into establishing.
I just have another question about the difference between association and causation. When you talk about association, it seemed as if one of the issues was an association would become a causative relationship if there was enough study done to demonstrate that. How much study does it take? I mean, it seems like in this case, there's only a couple of studies that have been done. And so how much study has to actually be done before you can establish a causative relationship out of a situation that was initially considered to be an association? And in the history of sort of this type of research, how often does that happen, where you have something that is initially considered to be an association, and then when the research is actually done, people discover that it actually was causative all along?
So we actually have a list of, you know, there are certain criteria that need to be met in terms of what, if you get the strength of studies to actually to go from association to causation. And, you know, some of the obvious ones, reproducibility, you have to actually have the pathway down, meaning you have to understand how it works in physiology. So there are definitely ways of, and the more of those criteria that are met, the more likely you are to have causation. And we've gotten there with things. We got there, you know, we got there with cigarettes and lung cancer. We got there with lead and developmental disorders in kids. So it is possible, absolutely, to get there, and we do it routinely. I'm not making any predictions about whether we'll get there with PFASs.
I mean, it's an intriguing question. It's really a very good question, and there's not one answer. But I will say, you know, reading the literature of PFAS doesn't always go in one direction. There are some studies that suggest an association statistically. There are others that don't reach statistical significance, but they talk about a trend. And then there are other studies that refute it, that they look for the same effects and didn't find them. So, that consistency and reliability are important factors.
Now, excuse me. Now that the state has completed this study using our blood samples, etc., has the state come any closer to determining who the responsible party is for our contaminated water? And if not, why not?
So I'm going to defer this question to some of the later speakers if they're able to answer that. You know, clearly, I'm here to talk about the public health piece.
Are they definitely going to have another time for blood testing? I was going to get it done in November, had a family emergency, and I called the state after, and they didn't have a time. I have gotten the second test that we were supposed to have done at the hospital. That was the second blood test that we were supposed to do, but I haven't gotten the original one for the PFOA. So do you know if there is going to be a definite time?
We are planning to do another clinic, again, for individuals who haven't been tested already.
Okay. In the near future, next?
Yes.
Okay.
With that being said, what happens if you haven't been tested and your doctor has drawn blood? Is there anywhere that it can be sent to be tested?
There are labs where it can be tested, commercially available labs. We can provide that information. I think the challenge is that if you introduce another lab, it's hard to compare the results to the results that we got. To be frank, the methodology we used, the preparation we used was pretty extraordinary to ensure that, again, because PFOA is everywhere, and you know, it's on the blood tubes, it's on the gloves that you draw the blood with, et cetera, et cetera. It's in the air when you mix the blood. It's a challenge to actually interpret the results in terms of validity. But the answer is yes, there are two labs.
Well, my doctor actually has my husband's blood that was drawn on Wednesday, and he passed away on Friday from all the cancers you're talking about. He worked in Hoosick Falls. We both did for 20 years. We moved over to Matson Road and found out we have the PFOA there. And I'd like to know who I talked to get the doctor to mail the blood.
So first of all, I'm sorry for your loss. Okay. And we can get you a list of labs that can do that.
Okay, thank you.
I just wanted to know about a lot of the medical data that you had about all the different diseases that can be caused. A lot of those are progressive diseases. And I don't know exactly how the data is compiled and where exactly it comes from. But it doesn't sound like there are that many cases that you have documented of serious problems related to the PFOA. But if a lot of it is progressive, like with thyroid disease or things like that, how is that possibly tracked? I don't understand how you can even assess the seriousness of this if you don't know everything that's going on with everybody and where it's going to lead. I know several people just in my small circle that do have things that are related to this that probably aren't on your list of documented things that, do you know where I'm coming from? Because my levels are very high. And to look at me, I'm a healthy individual.
Absolutely.
I've had my problems, though, you know, some things that may progress, and they are related to this right now. I'm fine.
Again, when you talk about causation, you're not talking about any of these conditions. So just to reemphasize that these are associations that have been shown in human studies, but that doesn't mean that this exposure caused that condition. And especially that study that I mentioned, the Knox study on thyroid, for example, none of those individuals, those 69,000 individuals that were studied, actually had thyroid disease. They had thyroid levels in their blood that they tried to correlate with the PFOA level, but they did not have thyroid disease. So it's a good, you make a good point. And it emphasizes the role of the primary healthcare provider and following up patients if they have those kinds of conditions. Who knows why they have those conditions? May not be related to their exposure at all, but if they're progressive, such as thyroid disease, then of course they need the medical attention and monitoring that they would ordinarily.
You mentioned earlier that in your wellness visits, the associated diseases are scanned or tested for in a normal wellness visit. Two things. One, how accurate and reliable are those tests? And is there any support information for primary care providers as to exactly which tests should be done or as to which method should be used?
So we do provide in this guidance document from ATSDR exactly what has been found in the literature. There is no, again, there's no specific tests that are recommended for people who've been exposed to PFOA. Most of the things that have been found to be associated, again, but not necessarily caused by exposure, are things like they check your blood pressure. It's routine that we'll go and get our cholesterol checked. We'll and things of that sort. We'll have our thyroid test and things of that sort. So most of them are found in the normal course of events, or things that talking to your provider and your doctor that you can have a discussion about. Are there other things that need to be done for specific some of the other diagnoses again that have been shown to be associated but not caused by exposure? But we do have that guidance.
I do understand what you're talking about in terms of 60 plus thousand people versus 400 or so people. The thing that doesn't make sense to me is when we were doing this blood testing, and there has been some indication that thyroid may be involved, that there's a test you can take while you're taking your PFOA test, and you can compare that to the general background of the populace, which is what they always do. We're on a big experiment until they get enough information that shows the bell curve is pointing towards something. And none of that was done. And nobody asked me to sign that they can look at my health record. So I don't see where, on this particular case with us in this area with the state of Vermont, where you're trying to correlate with people that have a higher blood PFOA in their blood and what they actually have for a health record. As I don't know if it's caused.
I agree with you, it's way out there to try to pin anything down, but I've definitely over the years, for many years, have had a thyroid that kind of goes wacko at times. And people know me for years as the person who would show up to work when it's below zero, and I'll come down off the parking lot in a t-shirt, it doesn't bother me in the least. And this is stuff that's been going on for years, so that's just my question. There's just nothing with this 400 people that I know of that got coordinated directly to their health record.
So again, to kind of emphasize, we did this study, that the primary reason for the study is to make sure that there was that there was a connection between contaminated water and the PFOA in your blood. You know, and that was proven to make sure we didn't need to do anything else to prevent further ongoing exposure. The health effects, we knew that there would be a limited value from the evidence we found there, based on the numbers. That was, and we did find some. And in terms of your thyroid, I think that's a wonderful thing for you to go and see your healthcare provider, talk to them about, and have the appropriate testing.
It's just when you're looking for a health problem, like I said, it just seemed to make sense that you'd be looking at the two sides of the equation to see even if it wanted to be, if there was a bell curve that's out of the norm, just like they take the PFOA number, because we all know there's a background all over the country of a number. Just seemed to make sense. Yeah. I just wanted to clear it, the study didn't go there. And I understand what you were doing. Thank you.
No, and I think finally, I understand what you're saying. I think in the end, we use the questionnaire as our tool to find those things like high blood pressure, like high thyroid disease.
Will your office, will the state of Vermont, so to speak, follow us and find out whether, in point of fact, our levels do decrease in 3 to 4 years?
So from a public health perspective, meaning, you know, looking at a population, protecting the health, there is no compelling reason to do that retest, given what we know about the blood and given what we know about all of the studies. So we have no plans to do that right now. Importantly, there's no relationship between a level and a specific having a condition or not having a condition, or having a condition caused by it. So the answer is we have no plans to do so at this point. And there's no, again, nothing you can do, or we know would advise you to do to reduce your level, short of ensuring that you're not exposed in your water.
Thank you.
And what we know from other studies that have already been done, the Haines study is the national study, is that over time, because these products have been discontinued, PFOA containing, levels reliably go down.
That's a concern, I feel like, because, so if we go to the doctors to find out if our levels are going down, we have to specifically ask for PFOA, because like my daughter's level, she hasn't been home for 3 years and she's almost 400. I feel like that would be important to be tested. Is that what we would do? Is when we go to the doctor and say, can we also have check our PFOA level? Because I don't know that.
As a pediatrician, as your daughter's pediatrician, we'd have a discussion about it. That's all I can tell you. I really understand that concern. And as I tried to emphasize my talk, the gap is we don't really even know what that level means. So the fact that it's going up or going down, hard to say. But that's a discussion you would have with your healthcare provider as the years go by.
But I feel like a huge emphasis is being put on the fact that it will go down, so have no worries. So
yeah, that's right. And rationally and objectively, that's what I would tell you.
All
that
right.
It will go down and you don't have to worry.
Okay, my second question about that was the people who have blood tests done in November, when will those results come back?
Within the next week or two.
Okay.
be frank, I'd love to hear about that round of testing. I'm not familiar with it. Any testing at the hospital? That was not coordinated by the Department of Health, nor recommended by the Department of Health.
Have you ruled out airborne transmission as an exposure method? And if so, was that done by your tests or by pre-existing studies?
Well, I think what we did was we made the direct connection between water and blood. I think the example, for instance, of people who are living at the Camp Fat plant, there's really a pretty strong evidence that it's not in the environment other than in the water. I don't know that we would be able to, I think the extent that I can answer. So that would be the way. Well, it's a strong statistical correlation. And it is clearly the primary pathway.
I have a question up here. A lot of the families that I speak to, they have had or live close to the Camp Fat plant talk about years ago having ash and soot come down on their house. Is that may not be right now, but back then, could that have caused an exposure that we're maybe not taking into account right now?
Get back up here. Call a friend.
It's a very short answer, but we really didn't assess any previous sources of exposure, including any inhalation that would have happened when the plant was in operation. If there are more questions, we'll be around for a few minutes afterwards. We're going to move along on the agenda. We just have a couple more people that will speak with you. And again, we will be here for a little bit after the meeting if you have a few more questions. I'd like to introduce our next speaker. She's going to talk to us a little bit about the resources available. Captain Summers is a commissioned officer with the U.S. Public Health Service, and she's currently the regional director for ATSDR, the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry in Region 1 in Boston, and ATSDR is a sister agency of the CDC. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Tara Summers. As mentioned, I'm with the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry. It's a really long name for an agency, so we tend to go by ATSDR. We are a sister agency to the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, which is headquartered in Atlanta. We share top administration with CDC, but we get appropriated separately through Congress, so that's why we're a separate agency. Like I said, we share some resources and administration. Is that feedback? Sorry. The uniform is the U.S. Public Health Service. Just to answer that question, people tend to ask what the uniform is. I can explain more about that. So here we go. So ATSDR works with communities to protect people from environmental exposures. We were established to look at contaminated sites and to provide public health assessments for those sites. A lot of this work is available on our website for different sites across the country for all sorts of different contaminants. And as I mentioned, our headquarters is in Atlanta. We have a small regional office here in New England out of Boston. That's where I am. And we do work with communities and with states. We investigate chemical exposures. We recommend actions to protect people from those exposures. We help try to do some public education. And sometimes we conduct a little bit of research, too, if we have the availability to do so. One of the big things I think we wanted to convey to you tonight is that, you know, we have been working with the state of Vermont. Sorry, I can't see the lower part of the slide from down here. So we've been working with the state of Vermont, and I wanted to just tell you a little bit about what we've been doing. So last February in 2016, the Vermont Department of Health reached out to us for some assistance with this PFOA contamination here in North Bennington. Two things they were sort of asking for at that time was there was this potential blood serum sampling project, which turned into your real blood serum sampling project that the state just presented on. We gave some technical advice for that based on experiences we've had with other communities where this type of projects or similar events have happened. And we helped with some technical assistance to the exposure questionnaire, which went along with that project. Also, as CDC is our sister agency, the NCH lab, which is the National Center for Environmental Health Laboratory, is in Atlanta with CDC. And that lab helped analyze the blood serum samples that were collected in Vermont. But just to be clear, the samples that the lab got were de-identified, so we didn't have anybody's personally identifiable information. The samples were analyzed for the contaminant, and that information was given back to the state. And then the state took that information and conducted the analysis you saw tonight. So just to be clear on what everybody's roles were. So what are we doing at ATSDR about this PFAS issue? So as you've heard, this is an emerging contaminant, and ATSDR has been working with many communities around the country. This map gets updated fairly frequently on our website, and probably there might even be a new one up this week. It just sort of starts to show you where some of the communities are, where we're working. In a lot of these communities, we're a partner agency with one of the state health departments. And I think as this contaminant becomes more routinely tested for across the country, you'll see this map change a little bit as other sites are identified. So we have materials available on our website for community members. We have fact sheets. We have information about these contaminants and your health. We have information about exposure, how to prevent exposure. It's all available at our website, which is on there. I brought a few of the fact sheets today. They're on the back table, I believe, but they're always available on our website. Or if you contact me, I can get you copies if you don't have access to getting onto the internet. We've also been doing a fair amount of work to develop materials for clinicians, because as these contaminants are found across the country, people have a lot of questions naturally, and they want to go to their medical provider to ask these questions. And you know, sometimes providers too aren't very familiar with some of these contaminants. So ATSDR has put together a clinician's guidance, which is a written document where it goes through the background of these chemicals and what types of, as we've heard already, what kind of associations have been found with them, and then what clinicians can do to help support their patients. And then we've also, there's a PFAS continuing education for clinicians. Again, that's all available on our website. If you go to that link, you can link to these other documents. You as community members can read the documents as well. The continuing education for clinicians provides CEUs for clinicians, and it's also on YouTube. So you can watch it there. So that's really short. I just wanted to give a little brief introduction to ATSDR and how we've been helping to support the state. And we'll continue to support the states and communities as these issues keep coming up. So thank you for your time. There's my contact information. You can always find me, call me, email me. I'll be here after. So thank you.
We have two more speakers to give you a few updates. When we were working with the Department of Environmental Conservation last year under the Agency of Natural Resources, we just had such excellent partnership, very fast acting, very inclined toward wanting to communicate and help the community as much as possible. So ANR has been a real leader in this with the state. And so with that, I would like to introduce the Secretary of the Agency of Natural Resources, Secretary Julie Moore.
Good evening. Thank you for having me. I'm really pleased to be here tonight and serving you in my role as the Secretary of Natural Resources. By way of introduction and background, I am a licensed professional engineer and have spent my entire career working on issues related to water resources. Water quality is something that's really near and dear to my heart. The communities of North Bennington and Bennington remain a top priority for our administration, and I want to assure you that there will be no change in approach, even though there's a new team in place, at least at the top. I say that because we will have the same technical and legal team in place that has been working on this issue from day one, and in fact, two of those folks are here with me this evening, Richard Spies and Jen Duggan. On behalf of Governor Scott, I want to tell you that our team continues to press for a long-term solution for the cleanup of the PFOA contamination. I can only imagine how anxious all of you are for information about the cleanup and the municipal waterline extensions. And I want to tell you that we're continuing to negotiate a long-term clean water solution with St. Gobain, including the municipal line extensions. We were surprised and frankly a little disappointed by St. Gobain's recent letter to Governor Scott. St. Gobain has been a strong partner during the initial response, providing residents, I'm sure as you know, with bottled water and filtration systems, and we remain hopeful that we can work together towards a settlement. Ultimately, the pace of the municipal waterline construction will depend on whether St. Gobain will be a partner with the state, and our goal remains to see construction start in 2017. As I said, we are hopeful that St. Gobain will continue to approach what needs to be done as a partner, but are also exploring other options to secure the long-term solution needed for PFOA contamination here in Bennington County. We will share any additional information about the status and the outcome of these negotiations as we are able to, although I hope you all understand that settlement terms need to be confidential at this point. No community should go through what you all are going through right now, and your patience and perseverance over the last year is commendable. I've been inspired by how this community has banded together. This was one of the first briefings I received in assuming this role, and in fact happened before I was even on the job. It is the number one issue in front of the agency. And I will continue to make getting a good result for all of you a top priority. So thank you for being patient and strong as we continue to work through this together. I know that Josh Diamond is here from the AG's office, but I'm also happy to answer questions that folks may have. Do you want to?
I don't need a mic.
Okay.
The previous secretary had said that the goal of the negotiation was to get a town water hookup for every person affected. Is the position Madam Secretary, should I call you?
You can call me Julie.
Is your position any different from the previous secretary?
So having a safe long-term solution for every resident in this community is our priority. We're hopeful that we know that municipal waterline extensions will be a significant part of that equation. As an engineer, I can also tell you that there may be locations recognizing sort of the large extent of the contamination where either from an engineering or a cost perspective, a different solution will make sense. But we are committed to long-term safe drinking water supplies for every resident.
I guess specifically I was concerned with, as I think you mentioned, the position of St. Gobain talking about the public system as being a long-term solution. That was a position rejected.
So for many homes, we believe that's true, that POETs are not going to be the most cost-effective long-term solution. We have a pretty comprehensive investigation process that we generally go through before making a determination about what the best remedy is that takes into account a lot of factors. In this instance, we were hopeful to move quickly with St. Gobain to implement municipal water supplies, and if we're unable to go that route, we would go through our investigation process and determine the best remedy on a house-by-house basis.
Well, we're past quickly now, aren't we? I mean, we're past quickly. And given the lawsuit that they just filed in the environmental court and their recent response to the lawsuit that our firm has brought, we'll adjust with other firms, it doesn't seem like that moving quickly is one of their priorities.
We remain hopeful that there's a possibility for settlement, That said, we were disappointed by the tone of the letter that they sent to Governor Scott recently and recognized that that may be a reflection of their current position.
Well, thank you, and thank you for your efforts.
So you might have already answered this, but maybe clarify. The pace of the solution or the remedy is going to be dependent upon the cooperation of St. Levain is still confusing to me. And then the second part is clarify what you mean with settlement terms are confidential when it affects all of us so very personally.
Sure. Maybe I'll do the second half of that first. While we're negotiating a settlement, the terms need to be confidential. There will be an opportunity for the public to view the proposed settlement before the state enters into it. So it's really just this negotiation phase. And I'm sorry that I was not clear with that. The other question you asked was about the timeliness of the resolution. So our hope has always been to go to construction in 2017. And there are sort of two ways to get to that construction. One is to reach settlement with St. Gobain where they agree to pay the costs. We've actually begun the planning work that supports the ultimate engineering design. It's called a 20% design, but essentially it's really the planning studies. That work we expect to complete in the next couple of months and is foundational for the solution moving forward. And so if St. Gobain is willing to pay for the waterline extensions, we could move immediately into final engineering design and then construction. If we are unable to come to settlement with St. Gobain, that's where the paths sort of diverge. One path would be for us to, and probably the path that we see as the most technically feasible, is for us to actually follow our site investigation process and develop a corrective action plan. And that's where we would go through and determine remedies on a place-by-place basis. The reason we would want to follow that process is because that would allow us to ultimately take St. Gobain to court and potentially recoup those costs. If we go outside of our process, it's very hard for us to defend the decisions we made. This is a legally tested process that we use on contaminated sites wherever they occur throughout the state. It's not related to PFOA. It's our site response approach. The other approach would be if we were able to find funds through our legislature and an appropriation or through the federal government somehow and could move forward in absence of having completed that investigation, that's another opportunity to potentially move more quickly, but we don't have any clear idea where those funds would come from at this point in time.
At the previous meeting that was held at this location, the previous person, if I remember correctly, made the statement that the state would move quickly and pay for all of the procedures needed, and then the state would go after St. Gobain to get the money back. But what I think I'm hearing you say now is different from that statement. What I think I'm hearing you say now is the state will do some planning and the end result is contingent upon whether St. Gobain will join in and contingent upon maybe some other money sources. And I'm hearing a lot more hedging in your answer than I heard at the previous meeting. Am I correct in my hearing?
I would say no. I think there's a couple pieces to unpack in your question. The first is that the ultimate long-term solution hasn't changed. What we're talking about is the timeline, really. And that I know that the commitment was made to work towards construction in 2017. That's still our goal. What I'm telling you is the path forward is a little less clear on that particular timeline right now, in part because while we've actively engaged St. Gobain as a partner, particularly in the emergency response, they seem to be slowing a little bit. If we don't follow our process, which is this, what we call our IROC process, which is what we go through to do the investigation and develop a corrective action plan, we run the very real risk of not being able to recoup the costs from St. Gobain. And so it takes time to go through that investigation. What we had anticipated was St. Gobain's continuing cooperation, which would obviate the need for this investigation process, and we would be able to move forward more quickly. So it's a change in timeline, but not a change in the ultimate goal, and we continue to push to move as quickly as possible.
I remind the state that, and I fully agree with the last gentleman of exactly what I heard at the last meeting, and the state was going to find some way to extend the water lines to everybody, because it's a big issue in terms of your whole retirement and what your house is worth. And I know what the state said, and I am clearly hearing the speak that we're backing off from that. It could be that if we don't get the money out of Safeco Banks, that we'll have some kind of procedure where you're gonna have these POETs forever, and they're gonna meet the, you already know that it meets your 5% standard by your test. But that is a whole different thing than what we were told before. And I just remind the state of one thing, is that your state employees had a health issue in Bennington. The state didn't have any money back then either. They spent $35 million in 4 years to solve a problem. I'm not a big fan of using other people's money, but it's the only way I feel that I'm gonna get any of my value for the future and to be able to even think about the retirement that we worked so hard to build a house on. So that's just my reminder.
Sure, I appreciate your concern, and just wanna make sure I was clear in the response I gave, which is the ultimate goal remains the same, and what we're talking about is a delay on the order of probably 6 to 18 months in terms of our ability to go through our process, get the information we need, develop the corrective action plan, and move forward to protect our right to recoup those costs from Saint-Gobain. This isn't an infinite due loop or a delay that will extend over many years.
I understand, but I have not heard you say all water line extensions. That has changed. I've heard you're going to look at it. I'm probably one of the ones, if you do build any of it, I'm low hanging fruit and I'm lucky, but I am concerned about the people that it's not easy to.
Sure, so we certainly hear what you're saying. And actually, in part of the planning process that we've been undertaking with the municipalities of the village of North Bennington and the town of Bennington, there are individuals who don't want to have to be tied on to municipal water. And so that's part of the decision-making process. There are other places where you have to look at the water quality of the water in the municipal line. And if there's not a lot of water moving through the line, sometimes some byproducts that can be generated inside the line, it doesn't make sense to run that water because it doesn't move enough. And so there are other factors than just tying everyone on. So that's one of the reasons why we go through this process, is part of our decision-making process is to work with the municipality, to work with the individuals, and then to look at all these other factors like permanence and cost and public acceptance and things like that. So that's all part of this process that the secretary was mentioning. And I think that's one of the reasons why maybe what you're hearing is a hedging, is in this process we have found a number of individuals who don't want to be tied on for a variety of reasons. And so to say everyone's going to get tied on would be an inaccurate statement.
Okay. I have your question. One statement about the POET system, you're aware of it, and that is the POET system lowers our volume of water in our homes drastically. We're being patient with low pressure water, low volume. So getting it done quicker us calm.
Secretary, has the stand up here. During this process with Saint-Gobain, has Saint-Gobain actually admitted responsibility to poisoning our water, or has the state actually, as a result of this study that Dr. Chen took care of, has the state come to a conclusion that they are the responsible party?
By negotiating with them, we're indicating our strong belief that they are the responsible party. I don't know, maybe our general counsel would like to comment on whether they've assumed responsibility. I assume that they wouldn't say that as they continue to negotiate.
Is that a negotiation piece that the state is undertaking, that we will refrain from identifying who's the responsible party as long as you continue to work with us? Is that perhaps involved in the process at all?
No, I don't believe so, but If you want to pass the microphone down, two rows in front of you is our general counsel.
I think that the, you know, the state has determined that Sacubon is a responsible party based on the information that we have. And we're continuing to negotiate with them for a long-term solution. So we believe we have information sufficient to identify them as a responsible party.
I'm feeling very discouraged. I was very optimistic and had full faith that the state of Vermont would ensure the fact that people who needed clean water, we would all have clean water and would not be dependent on the POET system, that either the money would be coming from St. Gobain if that was happening in a timely manner. If it was not happening in a timely manner, the state would move forward and secure the funds and then sue St. Gobain. But we would be having clean water, not our filtration system, within a reasonable amount of time. Suddenly, I don't know that I'm going to get clean water because I'm an outlier, my property. I also have actually no idea if the state is now committed to do that in what I would consider to be a timely manner, which would be this year.
Right.
And I'm not understanding clearly what it is that you're saying about going through procedures, yada, yada, yada. I'm not getting that. And I'm not hearing, yes, water will be clean. It will be delivered. You will not have to have the POET system after only. I don't want to depend on St. Gobain. This could go on to most dead and buried with no resolution.
So to be clear, the ultimate installation does not necessarily depend on St. Gobain. Our ability to move as quickly as we would hope would be facilitated by St. Gobain's cooperation, which we are concerned may be slipping a little bit. We're hopeful to continue to work with them as a partner. If we are unable to move forward with them as a partner, we will continue to pursue a permanent clean water solution for everyone affected, but that then requires us to go through our process. We've pre-qualified a contractor, so we're ready to go as soon as it becomes clear what the path forward is, and we're hopeful to have resolution on that in the next few weeks. Moving forward with the contractor, they've told us they need 6 to 12 months to complete that investigation and develop a corrective action plan, and there's some assumptions in there, which we hope will hold true, but depending on the level of investigation required, it could take longer. That work is really essential to our ability to recoup costs from St. Gobain. Once we've completed our work, we can move forward with implementation of the clean water solution and still preserve our right to go back and recoup payment from St. Gobain.
Can you tell me approximately how many years you're thinking? I've counted over a year already that you're thinking. Maybe in 1 year, we might have something that will allow us, if we ever are able to complete the money and St. Gobain is legitimate, we go for it. So I have 1 year plus, how much more, until the person can turn on their tap and have water?
To be clear, our goal and our strong hope and desire is that there will still be construction that is initiated this year. We are working with that as our goal. So beyond that, obviously there was phasing in the approach even as presented initially. It wasn't that every home would be connected in year one. A little bit of that would be determined based on the results of the engineering feasibility and timeline, what makes sense to construct where and when. But that work could begin once we have a corrective action plan.
Yes, can you just give clarification on, let's set aside the time frame. You're saying everyone will be provided clean water, but I'm a little confused on what that clean water will look like, because you are saying that some will be assessed on an individual basis. So everyone will be provided clean water through the public water system, or you will look at individual systems on their POET system. So that's what I need clarification on.
Sure, and that's some of the points that Richard had made. There's some residences have indicated that they may not want to be hooked to municipal water. There may be an option to drill a different well. It may be that some people would wish to keep their POET system, but that will be determined on a case-by-case basis, working with the residents as well as the municipalities to make sure that everyone has clean water.
Yeah, excluding those who wish to stay with their POET systems. Those who do not wish to stay with their POET systems.
Richard, can you help with the answer?
Sure.
I'm sorry.
So those who do not wish to keep the POET system, moving forward from that.
So that's certainly part of the entire evaluations of what the possible remedy is. As the secretary mentioned, we are looking at some locations where we may be able to drill new water wells and find clean water, even though they may have contaminated water. So a good example of that would be if they have a shallow well and it's contaminated, and maybe their neighbor's well next door, which is an artesian well much deeper, is clean. Perhaps we can, through doing some investigation, find a way to drill them a new well. And if that makes sense for the homeowner, that's something they're interested in, and if it makes financial sense, then we'd certainly investigate that as a possible remedy for that individual. And we've actually already started that process, so that's not well advertised, but that St. Cobain has stepped forward and identified some locations, and we've asked them to look at some other ones. So it is a more complicated system than just saying tie everyone on. And so we're trying to go through the entire process to do what's right for the entire community.
And those processes are worked through with the owners?
That's correct. That's part of the process.
Okay, thank you.
May I ask a question along these same lines that follows the same? Because my home is one of those homes that's on the perimeter. And it has been my concern throughout all of these meetings that my home and those other homeowners who were similarly situated would somehow be left out of this resolution, and that we would be left with POET systems for the remainder of our time, and then whoever the subsequent buyer of the home might be, they would have the POET system. Do I now understand that no homeowner will be required to remain with the POET system going forward? That if the municipal line cannot be run for whatever reason, engineering or other, that some other solution can be found, not just the POET system? And if it is just the POET system, will there be other compensation that's made to the homeowner for the dramatically reduced value of their property in relation to that POET system? Because I think that's the concern that a lot of, that those of us who are on the outskirts, this is at the heart of our concern, that we'll be left, and in all of the literature from different people's offices that I have read, there's always the caveat of reasonableness, and I understand reasonableness. But if you're on the other side of reasonableness, it doesn't sound very reasonable to you.
No, we certainly understand what your concerns are. You know, one of the factors we haven't brought into our discussion, and part of why we go through the process, is there may be cases where there are wells that are contaminated today, but we find out through maybe sampling or other approaches that maybe they're only going to be contaminated, which is still way too long, but for the next 3 years. Well, maybe in that case, people would be happy if they knew that, to just have the POET for 3 years and go back to using their water well. So those are the kind of processes why we have to go through this evaluation to come to a conclusion for every individual well. Because there are factors like that that we have to understand so that we can discuss them with you, so that we can come to some resolution for your consideration. You did mention financial restitution. I think I'd get in a lot of trouble if I touched that issue very much. But so it's not something I think the state is planning on doing any financial restitution for any individuals. We're trying to protect your public health and do that in the best manner possible.
And all of that sounds great, Richard, and I appreciate it. But you know, if we are stuck with, we can't dig a new well for this reason or that reason, and can't run a municipal line, and we are stuck with the POET system, clearly we have experienced a harm.
So we'll have more meetings on this issue, I promise you that, and as we go through this process, and you'll have plenty of opportunities to express that. Maybe we should save that for when we get a little further along, just seeing that this was really...
Well, for those of us who are in that situation, I want to make clear that, that we would not be happy with that resolution.
No, we've heard that. We understand that.
So we're going to try to move on. If there's a couple more questions, maybe you can come down at the end, just because we've got one more speaker to just give us a brief update. And that is Deputy Attorney General Josh Diamond. And again, a few people will be around for a few minutes at the end of the meeting if there's a couple of remaining questions. Please welcome Deputy Attorney General Josh Diamond.
Good evening, everyone. As you know, after 20 years, we now have a new Attorney General, T.J. Donovan. And General Donovan had hoped to be here tonight to show his solidarity with the folks here of Bennington, but unfortunately he was taken away on out-of-state business and has asked me to be here as his personal representative. I am also joined tonight by Laura Murphy, who is one of the assistant attorney generals from our environmental division, who has been working on these issues involving PFOA contamination here in the Bennington area. The Vermont Attorney General's Office is partnering with the Vermont state agencies, the Agency of Natural Resources, the Vermont Department of Health, in the common goal of ensuring access to clean water and protecting the residents of the Bennington area. This is a priority for General Donovan, and similar to what you heard from the Secretary, one of the first things that General Donovan did when he got into office a couple weeks ago was to get a briefing on the issue of PFOA contamination in this community and the state's efforts to obtain a remedy from Saint-Gobain with regards to that contamination. As you've heard, there are settlement negotiations underway, and we are hopeful that that will bring about a remedy in a timely manner to this community. But I want to convey to you all that our office, General Donovan, and the assistant attorney generals working in the environmental division are committed and stand ready to assist the Agency of Natural Resources and the Department of Health to obtain the remedy needed for this community to have access to clean water. So thank you very much. If there are any questions.
How much longer is the state going to give this company to finally settle? Are we talking about 6 months of negotiation, 3 months? Is there a time frame? Because they can keep running the clock, and we can just be waiting around. So what's the time frame?
So my office is not in the lead of these negotiations at this time. But my understanding, as communicated by the Secretary earlier, we're talking about a matter of weeks to determine whether a settlement process is really available, or we're moving into that, I think it was called the IROC process, which would inevitably lead to potentially a contested legal proceeding.
I just wondered if there's ever going to be a point in time where people realize that it would be more efficient to prevent this kind of thing from happening than to respond to it after it's happened. And if people in your position consider that and talk about that in your world.
Maybe the Secretary has some thoughts on public policy that could go towards in preventing that. Usually my office gets involved in the reactive mode to enforce the rights of the folks, but I'll defer to the Secretary.
Along those lines, there was a toxics work group that was formed after the last legislative session, and this work group met over the summer and has recently produced a report that talks about different ways to do exactly what you're talking about, including creating some inventories and reporting infrastructure on down to different ways that we could try to get ahead of our work on toxics and chemicals. And if you'd like more details after the meeting, I'm happy to give you information on where you can find that report.
Hi, two questions. One is for you, Secretary.
We have two remaining questions and then a couple of announcements. Thank you.
I'm here from the Rutland Herald, just so you know. So has there been a new Department of DC commissioner appointed yet?
that, no, a DEC commissioner has not been named yet. Joanna Polito is our acting commissioner at this point in time.
Okay, for the attorney. So are you saying that the Attorney General Donovan is committed to possible litigation if it gets upset?
If it is necessary to ensure the access to clean water, then yes.
Something I meant to mention a little earlier, the Senate Natural Resources and Energy Committee will be coming to Bennington on January 31st to hear comments on proposed legislation dealing with PFOA and other industrial pollution issues. So they're hoping to come and hear from residents, hear about your ideas. It'll be a two-hour session. It'll begin at 5 p.m. at Bennington College's Center for the Advancement of Public Action. So it's January 31st, 5 p.m. at Bennington's College, Bennington College's Center for the Advancement of Public Action. So just in terms of next steps from a health perspective, we will be announcing fairly soon the next clinic for people who have not been tested. We'll certainly be keeping you updated. We are monitoring, there are new studies all the time in this area. We're monitoring that information. We'll be providing that to communities via our website. We'll also be reaching out to healthcare providers about any new information or any new clinical guidelines that may arise. I'd also really like to thank Bennington College for providing this space and for being a great partner. Thanks to the state partners and thanks to you and the community. I recognize some of these answers are not perfect. It's really hard to be in an uncertain place, and I'm recognizing that, and I know there's some frustration there. And we are telling you everything we know, and we're being as transparent as we can, but still recognizing that that's not always fully satisfying. But we'll keep talking to you and keep sharing everything we know. So thank you so much for coming out. And if you have a few remaining questions, I think people might be here for a few minutes. Thank you.